You can barely see the Alaska Highway as the silt whips up from a dry riverbed. The Slims River used to be fed by a Yukon glacier. Not anymore. This is one of Canada's great northern routes, but it's changing fast. We came up here to the St. Elias Mountains to find out what this big ice can tell us about climate change. The Casco Walsh Glacier, 70 kilometers long, 5 kilometers wide.
I find the landscape inspiring. I love being out on the glacier and seeing the ice.
Gwen Flowers is a glaciologist from Simon Fraser University. She and her team are mapping the Casco Walsh.
What we're doing is we're using this ice penetrating radar system to measure the depth of the ice. So the transmitter here is sending little radio pulses through the ice. They are reflected off the bedrock underneath and they come back to our receiver box where they're recorded.
The team holds along the radar, traversing carefully to avoid crevices. The ice is over 800 meters deep in places, the largest ice field in the world outside of Antarctica and Greenland, and it's melting.
What have you noticed about the melt or the thinning in this on this Casco Walsh Glacier?
The thinning's really dramatic here. Over the range, we estimate that we are losing about a half a meter of ice per year. Glaciers are fantastic barometers of climate change. They average out the signals over time, so they tell us what's happening on a long time scale. So sometimes we think, oh, it's so cold this winter, you know, how could the planet be warming? But the glaciers are telling us that yes, over time, we have a warming planet.
The sheer size of these glaciers makes it hard to appreciate incremental change, but it's there. The melt is faster than before, and the snow cover can't replenish what's lost each year.
So even if we stop what we're doing right now, these glaciers would continue to retreat, but the choices we make now are really important for what happens after that on longer timescales, and they're incredibly important for what happens to big ice masses other places in the world, particularly the Greenland and Antarctic ice sheets, that together have about 65 meters of equivalent sea level stored in their reservoirs.
Gwen Flowers is one of the foremost experts on glaciers in southwest Yukon. Doing fieldwork here almost every summer for the last 13 years, including maintaining a weather station, part of her climate calculation. On the ground from a tiny hut, she processes the data with Jeff Crompton, a PhD student, and Laurent Mingo, an engineer.
So to paint a picture, in Canada, we have about 35% of the world's glaciers and ice caps. So those are the smaller ice masses outside of Greenland and Antarctica. So we as Canadians are stewards of about a third of the world's mountain glaciers and ice caps. And this is our responsibility.
Every few days, weather permitting, Gwen's team packs in their equipment, then heads out to some unique field labs on the glaciers.
And how old are these glaciers, Gwen?
Well, we would have had ice cover here through the last ice age, so this area has been occupied by ice for a very long time. In the smaller glaciers, though, the ice turns over a period of decades or hundreds of years, so the actual ice that you might sample would be a couple of hundreds to a couple of thousand years old.
We're looking to land on the ridge of a glacial phenomenon with the clear markers of a warming planet.
So what are we looking at here? What we're seeing are the remains of an ice-dammed lake. So if you would have been here 6 weeks ago, you would have seen this whole basin filled with water.
6 weeks only?
Yeah. That water is impounded by the ice dam, and that dam releases suddenly and allows the water to escape.
Where does it go?
So this water drains through that tunnel you can see there, 50 kilometers under the Casco Walsh Glacier, all the way to the glacier terminus.
Only icebergs are left, stranded. The whole process will repeat itself next year. And over time, the lake gets lower.
So we can see these lines that mark the previous high water level. And what we can really see is that there are lines there way above where the ice is today.
How convinced are you that that's human doing?
A significant component of it is our responsibility. And it turns out that in the last two decades, we as humans are responsible for about 70% of the mass loss from small glaciers and ice caps.
Hundreds of years ago, there was a glacier coming right down this valley. It's gone. But another one at the top here and around the bend called Glacier 1 is now dying too, at a rate faster than in the past. In these mountains, there's more glacial ice being lost than from any other alpine area in Canada. Here's one stark example. This is the Casco, Walsh Glacier back in 1900. Today, its terminus or end is in retreat. So much that the glacial water which used to feed the Slims River has taken another route to a different river, the Casco, Walsh, leaving the Slims River basin drier and the lake it feeds, Kluane, thirsty. This area is part of Kluane First Nation, and Bob Dixon is the chief.
So what do they call this now? It's not a river.
No, it's more, we haven't figured that one out yet, but it's more just a creek, right? It's just being fed by some of the local creeks here.
Yeah.
So it's
Slim's Desert.
Like it used to be.
Yeah.
When the sand's blowing, it's hard to see the crossing this little stretch of highway here. You have to slow right down to almost a crawl to get across here because of the sand that's blowing up from here.
So do you need any convincing that climate change is real?
Not for us in the Yukon.
For generations, Kluane Lake was filled by that glacial water. But at small communities, Burwash and Destruction Bay, the lake has pulled away from the shore. Boats can't access some parts of it, and spawning areas for salmon and trout have shrunk. Kluane First Nation still fish and hunt, and every year at a culture camp, they teach members traditional ways, like smoking moose for the winter. The trout and whitefish populating Kluane Lake have been bountiful, but the lake's future is now a question.
Our lake right now is 8 to 10 feet lower than what normally would be at this time of the year.
Does it worry you?
Well, we're going to have to learn to live with this. We can't change it. Hunting areas, fishing areas, all are changing, so we have to learn all that all over again.
This fragile lake borders Kluane National Park and Reserve. It draws some 30,000 tourists and adventurers a year, and Parks Canada is sounding an alarm. We caught up with Superintendent Diane Wilson.
I mean, a 20% difference in area coverage of the glaciers in Kluane National Park and Reserve and the rest of the UNESCO World Heritage Site, that's unprecedented. And in such a short period of time, 60 years, we've never seen that. It is outside the scope of normal. People are so excited to come and visit this wonderful place, but they should know that it's changing.
How long have you been running this, Andy?
Since 73.
Wow, it's almost half a century there.
Don't rub it in, dear.
Andy Williams came up here to manage the Kluane Lake Research Station. He flew teams into the ice fields. Good. Now his company flies in adventurers and tourists too.
Secure.
This is a sacred place for Andy. He can name the peaks and the glaciers, and he's watched them change.
So the retreat and meltdown in my time, the glacier is getting thinner, and that is a prelude to a full retreat, which we will be seeing not too long in the future.
We're flying into some ice fields six times the size of the ice cover in the Rockies. We can see Canada's highest peak, Mount Logan, through the clouds.
Andy, people say glaciers recede. That's the normal state of affairs. That's what ice does. What do you say to that?
Not at the speed it's doing it at the moment. We're noticing further up to in areas like this where the melt is making it more and more difficult for us to operate at, even at these altitudes.
Why should Canadians care about all this ice?
Well, I would say that water is probably our major natural resource. Certainly, when you translate the changes that are occurring here into areas like the Andes or the Himalayas, where there are millions of people relying on a steady flow from glaciers to provide irrigation and drinking water, then the results are catastrophic.
Yukon's mountains are a critical part of understanding climate. It's already warmed up 2 degrees here in the past 50 years, with at least another 3 degrees predicted by the turn of the century, unless things change. It's why Gwen Flowers is so determined to share the glacier's story.
All right, Gwen, we're headed off again. Where are we headed now? We're headed over to a small glacier here that's currently surging. We just found this in July.
We can see the craggy tops of a surging glacier. With enough mass, it can move a meter a day for a year or two, and this one is.
You know, less than a few percent of the world's glaciers surge, so this is a pretty special dynamic, and it really offers a great opportunity to understand glacier dynamics.
Do you like it?
I like it a lot.
So great. Oh, like it's even, it's just as good as July, even better. Like, did you see those sheared off tributaries?
Oh yeah.
I mean, it's just like, oh, it's just amazing.
They're setting up a time-lapse camera to watch this glacier over the winter. Out here in the howling wind and bitter cold, these scientists are trying to grab Canadians' attention.
So I think as Canadians, given our responsibility to be stewards of this ice, I think we could be doing better. I think Arctic science should be a priority. I think understanding our terrestrial and marine ice should be a national priority.
The mountains and their ancient ice have truths to tell about our future. Someone needs to be listening. Susan Ormiston, CBC News, in the St. Elias Mountains, Yukon.